Hello everyone, I'm Miss Trish. I'm one of the RE teachers with UU St. Petersburg, and I'm here with the lesson for the 31st of January 2021. This lesson is called Visit Other Worlds. I'll light the chalice and get started. Love is the spirit of this church and service its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. Our faith talks a lot about using reason to analyze the world and using action to change the world. But UU religious educators are reminding us that we also need to nurture our imaginations so we can dream up new worlds. Whether it's through stories like The Lord of the Rings or classic fairy tales like Cinderella, there is something powerful about using our imagination to create new places to visit. It allows us to transcend our limits and indulge in an escape now and then. It also allows us to learn life's lessons while in a pretend world. What's one of the ways our faith guides us into becoming a people of imagination? It tells us, use your imagination to visit and dream up other worlds. When we just pretend, it gives us a break. Here's one of my friends I use my imagination with. She's a mermaid. And I call her Big Mama Mermaid. In my imagination, Big Mama Mermaid is the mother of all mermaids, and she has lots and lots of grandchildren. So, how would we use our imaginations to find her world? Do we shrink ourselves down to her size? Does she just start talking to us? Do we have to follow her somewhere? Are there special words we have to say? Now, what do we see this mermaid's world to be like? What kind of a dwelling would a mermaid live in? Would it be a hole in the ocean floor, or maybe a giant clamshell? And what would her bed be made of? Or would she just sleep floating in the water? What kind of friends do mermaids have? Maybe her best friend is a starfish or an eel? What would they say to each other? What kind of things would they like to do together? What kind of things would cause problems for a mermaid? And how would a mermaid find the solution? What would they learn? Then how do we get back to our own real world? Do we take anything with us? What will the mermaid be like in the real world if she comes with us? Each time we play Let's Pretend with a mermaid, it will be even richer. We're able to pretend and learn about some of our own problems and even learn about some solutions, just like we did in the mermaid's world, solving her problems. What would we be able to take a little break and use our imaginations? I'm going to read you a story from a book that you can get at the library, or you can buy it. We'll post a link for you to listen to a read aloud audio on YouTube, or you can buy the book if you'd like. The book is called Fairy Houses, written by Tracy Kane and illustrated by her as well. If you'd like to, you can get comfortable and maybe even get a pad and a pencil and draw pictures while I read you this story. This summer, my parents decided we would leave the city and spend the summer on an island off the coast of Maine. They said there was something special for me on the island, something I would really like, but they wouldn't tell me what it was until we got there. As soon as we got off the boat, I tried to guess. Is it a lighthouse? Those silly sandpipers on the beach? The seals? Our cottage? Later, when we went for a walk in the woods by our cottage, I discovered the secret my parents had been keeping. Fairy houses. People had built small fairy houses for fairies to live in. You may build houses small and hidden for fairies, but please do not use living or artificial materials. I asked if I could build a fairy house. My dad said yes, as long as I follow the rules of the woods. I scouted out places that would be just right for a fairy house. I chose a hollow at the base of an oak tree and collected some twigs, some leaves, and pieces of bark to build with. I finished the inside with a floor of dry grass and made a roof of fallen leaves. I hoped the fairies would choose my house for a place to live in. The next morning, I couldn't wait to visit the woods again to see if anyone might be sleeping inside my house. When I bent down to look, I heard chirping. Was a fairy snoring? "Hey, you're not a fairy," I said. "You're a cricket." A cricket hopped off into a bush full of bright red berries. Maybe the fairies would like some to eat, I thought. I gathered a handful of berries from the ground and sprinkled them around my house. The following day, after visiting the lighthouse with my parents, I decided to check on my fairy house. A pair of finches were carrying the last berries away in their beaks. Searching the ground for more berries, I came to a small stream. The sound of the tinkling water gave me an idea. I took some stones from my pack that I had found near the lighthouse and arranged them in a circle near my fairy house. Then I filled the circle with water from the stream, in case the fairies got thirsty or wanted to take a bath. "Anybody here?" I whispered the next day. At first, the house looked empty. Then I spied someone in the pool. I wanted to get a closer look at the frog as he bathed. Oops, I guess I got too close. As the frog leaped away, I could hear other frogs singing out to him. I started singing myself as I got to work collecting acorns and pine cones. It was time to make some home improvements. When I came back the next afternoon, I saw a squirrel nibbling on the nuts, but no fairies in sight. I just couldn't give up. I still hoped the fairies would visit my house. Maybe it needed a better entrance. In my pack were seashells and feathers my mom and I had found at the beach. I decorated the path leading up to the door. I thought about adding my shiny bracelet to one of the shells, hoping to catch the fairy's attention. But then I remembered the rules of the woods. The next morning, I got up very early when my parents were still asleep and tiptoed out of our cottage and into the woods. This is the day we would be leaving the island, so I had one last chance to see my fairy house. A fog had rolled in off the ocean, covering the woods like a thick blanket. I could barely see. It was like walking in a cloud. The trees seemed huge, and their branches looked like arms reaching out to grab me. Goosebumps started popping out on my arms and legs. Someone was watching me, I was sure. Should I turn around and run? But my fairy house was so close. It was then that I heard footsteps and saw a large, dark shape heading towards my fairy house. My heart started thumping. I jumped behind a tree to hide. I caught my breath. It was a deer licking the salty seashells. I stood perfectly still as I watched her. She made her way lazily through the woods and vanished into the mist. Exhausted, I sat down near my fairy house, watching, waiting, and wishing for fairies to appear. The quiet of the woods and the soft mist made me sleepy. My eyelids felt heavy, but I tried not to fall asleep. Before long, the sun started breaking through the mist, and it came with a soft breeze. "Kristen," the breeze seemed to whisper in my ear. "Kristen, wake up. We can only stay a moment." Struggling to open my eyes, I saw a bright beam of light and a tiny smiling face. "We are the fairies that live in the spirit of the animals and plants that live in these woods," a voice said. "Of all the houses here, the animals have chosen yours to visit. You have treated the woods with care and respect. Look quickly, Kristen, for this is a moment of magic when the fairies will show themselves as a way of thanking you." As the late morning sun started breaking through the mist, light beams illuminated the fairies. They sparkled like jewels. They became so bright, I had to close my eyes. When I opened my eyes, the fairies had changed into beautiful monarch butterflies. Butterflies fluttered around me like a great orange cloud, following me to the edge of the woods where the sun shone brightly. I watched them dancing towards the light, higher and higher. Squinting into the warm golden day, I smiled and waved as the last butterfly disappeared into the sky. How to get started with your own fairy house. Fairy houses can be created in many different places. Look for building spots in parks, fields, woods, beaches, and your own yard. Try to find a place away from roads or busy pathways. The base of a tree or the side of a rock would be just right. Sometimes you can find a place in the low branches of a tree or bush. Close to the ground is best. You should use only natural materials to build the house. Grasses, pebbles, sticks, shells, feathers, seaweed, pine cones, and nuts are just some of the materials you can use. Be careful not to disturb or use any of nature's materials that are still living, such as flowers, ferns, mosses, or lichen. Fairies do not like to disturb anything that is growing. Many fairy houses look so natural, they are almost hidden. You can have fun building them any time of the year. Spring is a great time to build a fairy house in the woods. There are plenty of fallen branches and barks to get started with. Pine needles and leaves make good roofs and soft floors. Pine cones become trees and acorns a snack. A ladder made of twigs would tempt any fairy to climb up and take a peek inside. This might be a good place for you to pause the video and share your ideas about where you would build your fairy house and what kind of materials you would look for to build it. So for now, I'm going to pass the microphone to Miss Janae and she'll continue the session. Thank you for joining us here, and please be well and happy, and know that you are loved. You can close your eyes and feel it. Namaste.